Well, now, Rupert Reed, from Green City Councillor to Member of the European Parliament, it's quite a leap, really. What's given you the ambition to make it?
Well, John, I think what it is, really, is that I looked at the state of the world and thought things could be so much better. I wanted to work on a bigger plane than I've been able to so far. We've done some really significant things in Norwich City Council, and I'm proud of them. For example, my role in starting to roll out 20-mile-an-hour speed limits across residential areas in Norwich. And there are many more things I could name. But ultimately, one's only affecting Norwich. What I'd like to do is get into a place where one can affect the whole of the country, the whole of Europe, indeed the whole of the world. And so I decided that the best thing to do is to stand for us for the European Parliament.
Well, at the moment, about half of the MEPs that represent the Eastern region seem to see it as their job, to a greater or lesser extent, to try and put the brakes on what the European institutions are trying to do. They use phrases, don't they, like meddling in British affairs or undermining the British sovereignty. Now, are you a Eurosceptic too?
The Green Party's attitude is a bit more nuanced than that. I regard myself as Eurocritical, but not Eurosceptical, by which I mean I'm prepared to constructively criticise the European institutions, and there's some serious criticisms that need making. For example, the fact that the accounts haven't been passed the last 14 years, that's really pretty disgraceful. And many people are aware of the scandals that have involved the UKIP MEPs themselves. For example, Tom Wise, he was elected a UKIP MEP here in Eastern Region in 2004, and now he's been arrested for essentially defrauding the taxpayer. So there's lots wrong with Europe and lots of changes we'd like to make. But at the same time, there's lots that the EU institutions can deliver for us that nobody else can deliver. Look at the constructive role played, for example, by the EU in addressing acid rain or in reducing packaging. There are some things that can happen only at an international level, and the Green Party is fully supportive of the EU institutions when they're doing things that need to be done on an international level.
So how do you think you might actually be able to use the powers available to you in Europe to change your own region?
That's a nice question. There's lots to say in response to it. I'll give just a couple of examples. My first example would be transport. Transport policy is my own speciality. It's something that I'm very aware of and have built up a lot of knowledge of. And what I would like to do is to get onto the Transport Committee in the European Parliament and influence EU transport policy. At the moment, the EU spends a lot of money on transport, and most of that money goes on big international road projects. Now, as a Green, I think that's really a mistaken allocation of resources. What I'd like to see is a lot of that money going to much smaller scale projects, into cycling, walking projects, into public transport projects. And I'd like to see some of that happening here in Eastern Region. The other example I was going to mention, where I'd like to bring more goodies, if you like, to Eastern Region, is in relation to renewable energy. We've got this idea in the Green Party, we call it the Green New Deal. We want to have a massive investment in energy efficiency, in renewable energy, in other measures that would provide good green jobs, stabilise the economy, and at the same time improve our environment. So the Eastern Region has enormous potential on the renewable energy front. Obviously, yes, we're aware of wind energy, but we think there should be massive investment here too in wave and tidal power. And that's something I'd really like to bring more of to the region.
I suppose some people might be a bit worried that by voting Green, they're committing themselves to a rather stern ideology, and you certainly have your own agenda, and that perhaps you might look upon the plight of, say, the European car industry at the moment and be more or less indifferent about that.
You know, it makes terribly bad economic sense to provide big subsidies for the car industry. I read an article recently suggesting that for every job that you subsidise in the car industry, you could subsidise about 100 jobs in certain other manufacturing sectors or in service industries. It's just incredibly, I could barely believe the numbers when I saw them, it's incredibly inefficient. What Obama's doing in America is quite interesting, and this might be worth investigating. What he's saying to the big car manufacturers in America is, we will give you some subsidy to keep you, help keep you alive if you revolutionize the way you're designing your cars and make them genuinely a lot more fuel efficient and genuinely a lot more easier to recycle, for example, at the end of their lives. That's hugely important and is often left out of the debate. So I think there are ways in which we can effectively look at subsidising car manufacturers in Europe, but we would not favour the way in which at the present time the British government, the German government and the EU institutions look like they might be giving car manufacturers in effect a blank cheque, which is really not making good economic sense at all.
Well, now, it's true that the proportional representation voting system that's used in the European elections does favour the fortunes of the smaller parties, and last time around it favoured UKIP. Don't you think that the prevailing mood of Euroscepticism in this country might mean that it favours UKIP again, or even the BNP?
Well, the rise of the BNP is obviously a worry to all of us, to all right-thinking people. I don't think the BNP, however, are going to do that well in this region, at least in the east of England. They've actually got very little strength here, and we beat them by some margin at the last European elections, even though our result at the last European elections was a disappointment to us. We were at least still some way ahead of them. In terms of UKIP, I think you're absolutely right. Their star does seem to be setting. They've got a lot less money than before. They've been mired in all sorts of unpleasant scandals. I mentioned earlier that Tom Wise, one of their MEPs here, has been arrested for fraud, essentially. He's been caught on tape by the News of the World saying all sorts of unpleasant things about how he likes to milk the taxpayer. UKIP came in on a sort of clean hands ticket saying, oh, European institutions are bad, we'll clean them up. The truth has proved to be absolutely the opposite. I think that UKIP are going to do a lot worse this time than they did last time. So that leaves us a real opportunity. If the BNP can be held at bay here in Eastern Region, and I think they can, with the Labour government so unpopular and with UKIP very much losing votes compared to last time, we think we can come through the middle and take a seat. We only need about 10% of the vote, so I'm really hoping that 1 in 10 people in this region will get out there and vote Green, and we could get a Green MEP.
Well, now, you referred yourself a bit earlier to the way that there have been scare stories surrounding MEPs' allowances and expenses being bent. And of course, it's very easy for you to say, well, I shall have a highly ethical approach about that. But isn't there a danger that you might also get kind of swept along by the European gravy train?
Well, our existing MEPs here in England from the Green Party have an outstanding record on this front. For example, Caroline Lucas, ethical politician of the year last year. We've been campaigning strongly against the ridiculous travelling circus to Strasbourg, where all the MEPs go over there and all their offices go over there. Enormous waste of energy, of time and of money. And we're now campaigning very strongly on lobbying. This is something which the other parties don't talk about that much. There are enormous numbers of corporate lobbyists in Brussels and in Strasbourg. And the influence of large corporations and of big money upon the European institutions is far, far too much. We want to see a much stricter rulebook and for the corporate lobbyists to be restrained. So the Green Party MEPs have got a strong record on this. I hope to join them in this. I myself am a Quaker. I pride myself on not telling lies. It's not many politicians that can, in all honesty, say that. So I'm optimistic that people are going to think that actually here are politicians who are trying to live differently and do differently.
Now, the trouble is, some of that sort of sleaze has stuck in the public mind, hasn't it? And that may be one reason why people don't really feel engaged with what happens in Europe. And, of course, another reason is it all seems to be going on so far away. Do you think there's any way in which you can improve engagement at local level and get people to vote, I mean, almost whether or not they vote Green?
Absolutely. I think it's a really important question. One of the things I've been trying to do along these lines is I've been touring around the region, listening to people a lot, not just campaigning and giving speeches and handing out leaflets, but going and talking to green business people or small business people, talking to people on their doorsteps, trying to engage with people and listening to them about their concerns rather than immediately telling them the answers that I've got. Now I'm going to move more into a vein of kind of saying, here's what I think should be done in the latter part of the campaign, which is still to come. But I think that it's if you do listen to people, and it's something that Obama did a certain amount of, and I think it did well for him, if you listen to people and start from their concerns, that's a good place to start from, and I think more of our politicians should do that. I'm really in this campaign to try to give people hope. The Green Party message is a message of hope. What we're saying is we can look for solutions, not scapegoats. What we're saying is we can make Britain and Europe a better place to live, that people's lives can be improved. That's really what we're about. So the Green message, I think it's a message of hope, it's a message of a better life, and I hope that it's going to energise people to come out and put their crosses in the right place on June the 4th.
All right, Rupert Reed, thank you very much.
Thank you, John.